Patriots and Dolphins tried to follow the bouncing ball. In Pittsburgh, Joe Montana and the 49ers ran into a new steel curtain. In New Orleans, the Saints' prayers were answered, the Browns were not. In Tampa, Vinny will sit because DeBerg was the real thing. A head knocker in Mile High Stadium as the Broncos and Seahawks were all business. All that and much more coming up on NFL Primetime. Once again, everybody, I'm Chris Berman. Welcome to ESPN's debut of NFL Primetime, and we hope this becomes a habit through the 16 weeks of the regular season and on to the playoffs, as we're going to delve into the ball games throughout the Sunday each week in the NFL like nobody has before, and we like to think nobody will thereafter. Tom Jackson will be with us. Pete Axthelm will be with us. Gail Gardner will be with us. John Saunders will be with us. I tell you, we're loaded. Two late games going on right now. Let's get you caught up on those scores. Big game out at Mile High Stadium in Denver between the Seahawks and Broncos. Seahawks led it at one point, 17-7, but the Broncos have scored, now make that 33 straight points, 40-17, the Broncos rolling at home. Also going on at Green Bay, the L.A. Raiders right now pitching a shutout, waning moments of the fourth quarters. The Raiders lead the Packers by a score of 20-0. And if you were with us on game day, you saw us introduced before. Tom Jackson, a man who played and excelled 14 years at outside linebacker for the Denver Broncos. And I know your eye is peeled to Mile High Stadium, but have you recovered from watching 13 games in the span of 6 hours?
Well, 13 games are awfully difficult to watch, and they held interest for me. But the one that's going on in Mile High Stadium is where my heart is right now.
You didn't show that at all today, though.
Oh, not much.
That got a rise out of the studio. Here we have a small studio audience. Quick glance at Sullivan Stadium today, and the score for the Patriots-Dolphins game might have told you that any sort of quality football would be impossible. This isn't the Netherlands. No, that's not the dike bursting. But Don Shula, beginning his 25th straight year, is looking like, well, he'd rather be on a beach somewhere. First quarter, special teams take on important. Scott Schwades, the rookie, Syracuse, returns the first punt of the game until he's knocked out of bounds by Rich Camarillo on the 26-yard line. Short time later, Marino, play fake, passing, finding, 9 yards, Mark Duper, 7-0, the Dolphins lead in the pouring rain in Foxborough. Following a missed Patriots field goal, Miami on its next possession. Trouble. Reggie Roby, after the bad snap, is nailed by Rod McSwain. A leg injury. And, Tom, in the first quarter, Roby got hurt, the punter.
Well, unfortunate, because he's such a good punter, and I don't think the turf had anything to do with this. The player just rolled over on his leg.
Dislocated ankle and a groin problem, so Roby carted off the field, adding to Miami's problems, although they had the lead. New England proceeded down to the Dolphins' four-yard line. Watch Steve Grogan on this play to Tony Collins. Look at 14.
People talk about how fragile quarterbacks are, but at least Grogan got out there and attempted to throw a block.
He did it well. He set an illegal pick, at least. It was 7-7. First play of the second quarter, Don Strock punting. That's right, number 10. First NFL punt, not too bad. 33 yards, the result better. Irving Fryer with the ball. Fumbles. A quarterback punts. Another quarterback recovers it. Jim Jensen, crash, number 11, picks it up at the Dolphins at the 48-yard line of New England. Good fortune for Miami. And Marino goes up top to capitalize. 25 yards to Duper. 14-7. That combination has worked twice. More punting follies with Rich Camarillo of New England. Look at him. Low snap. Unloads. And Miami elects to let it bounce because it'll obviously go in the end zone, right? And a 5 and the 2 and the 1 and... Oh, it does barely go over. 73 yards. Camarillo says, boy, I have bad touch. Late in the second quarter, Miami on the move again. Marino looking to the other half of the Marx brothers. This time it's Mark Clayton, the catch at the 1 yard line. They would then call timeout late in the half. And when you got Jaworski, Strock, Marino, and Shula, you know there's some offensive minds there, Tom.
Yeah, I think they're discussing passing the ball. Marino is one of those guys, when he gets down close to the end zone, doesn't have a lot of faith in the running game, likes to throw it in.
You love that, though, don't you? Ron Davenport, 1 yard TD. 30th time, 66 games, Marino, 3 touchdown passes in one game. Unbelievable. 21-7 Dolphins. But then, Grogan to Irving Fryer. Goes over the head of Paul Langford. 17-yard play. The fans celebrating 21-14 now. New England within the touchdown at the half. New England drives when they get the ball in the second half. Look at the right side of the Dolphins' defensive line. The tight end, Greg Beatty, right there on number 97, John Bosa. clears the way for Tony Collins, who makes a brilliant scamper toward the end zone, hit by Glenn Blackwood, but dives for the touchdown and ties it at 21. New England then gets its biggest turnover of the day. Marino to Bruce Hardy. Bruce can't hold on. Ronnie LaPet out of midair, 20 yards for the touchdown. The Patriots have the lead. LaPet says, you know what, I am not a crook, but it's 28-21 Patriots. Don Strock then became the story of the game. Punting, Strock never punted before? Yeah, coffin corner out at the two. Don, he's psyched. Then, later on, watch Strock. You think he can, that was luck? This thing also goes out at the two. Don Strock, veteran punter now, says, yeah, this is easy. Late in the fourth quarter, Marino. It wasn't so easy for him. Brent Williams and Garen Barris sandwich him. Watch Barris' leg kick him up right there. Hits him in the eye. Marino forced to leave the game, and so the backup punter is now the backup quarterback. Less than 2 minutes to go, down by a touchdown. Don Strock takes over. Fourth and four. Strock to Crash Jensen. First down from the Patriots 42. Clock winding down. Strock to Mark Duper. 26 yards to the Patriots 16. Then with 12 seconds to go, Strock to Jim Jensen, down to the Patriots 3. Timeout, 5 seconds to go. Strock goes to the sideline, talks the play over with Don Shula. Delay of game, we're back in the 8. Strock then looks for Fred Banks. Incomplete, but the Dolphins still have fourth down, right? Wait a minute. The officials say, well, it's wet, it is time to go. Nobody can understand. Look again, and you see that the clock started late, Tom.
Well, we looked up the rule. They keep the official time on the scoreboard clock. Now, it didn't start for 2 seconds after the play started, and I guess they figured they owed him 2 seconds.
Well, I guess so. The line judge takes over on the field as Raymond Berry walks up with a victory, and so New England, as they usually do, although this was not easy, beating the Dolphins at home 4 out of the last 5 years in Foxborough, 10 out of the last 12 years, and today a big one. The Patriots beat the Dolphins by the score of 28-21. In a losing side in the pouring rain, Tom, I think you have to be impressed with the way that Dan Marino, I mean, 3 touchdown passes, 30 times in 66 games. He's almost unstoppable. You've tried to do that.
Well, he's almost unstoppable, but the thing today is that I was very surprised that he was able to throw the ball that well in that weather. Defensive people wake up in the morning of a game and see it raining, and you're like, yeah, you know, this is our kind of ball game. Marino destroys that theory.
Steve Grogan did not begin well in this ballgame for New England, but he got a chance to, he got some breaks, and the Patriots started to run the ball a little better. At least we saw on those runs by Collins. That's a key for them this year, isn't it?
Well, I think they have to run the ball, but Grogan has great experience, and he's the kind of guy that you can depend on to pull you out of some tough ballgames.
Easton is ready to go, but it's Grogan that got the start today, and the Patriots beat the Dolphins by a touchdown. Next, the team of the 70s proves that it's not dead in the 80s. As the Steelers frazzle the 49ers. San Francisco was not the only NFC West team to crumble. The Rams found Love You Blue to be a bad song. Stay with us.
There's a thief in this attic. This skimpy amount of insulation can rob you blind on your fuel bill.
Your house in the pink.
NFL Primetime is brought to you by Thrifty Car Rental. For worldwide reservations, call 1-800-4-CARS. And by Michelob. So exceptionally smooth, the night belongs to Michelob.
When the best in the NFC's West took on a pair of supposed also-rans in the AFC Central, on paper, it looked easy. But you see, that's why they don't play football games on paper, as Gail Gardner certainly can attest to. Welcome, Gail.
Thank you, Chris. Luckily for most of us, they don't play these games on paper. And as Chris alluded to earlier, it was billed as the team of the 70s against the would-be team of the 80s, the Pittsburgh Steelers and the San Francisco 49ers at Three Rivers Stadium. And if you were told that the Steelers had a winless preseason for the first time in 22 years and Mark Malone was just 9 of 33 today, well, you probably would make an assumption that things are not always what they seem. Joe Green on hand, the great defensive tackle. The Steelers from 69 to 81 received his Hall of Fame ring today before the game. Shades of the steel curtain, and they were hoping for something like that today. First quarter, Joe Montana's pass is picked off by cornerback Dwayne Woodruff. He's back after a knee injury that sidelined him all of last season, the 25-yard return, but they were unable to capitalize as Gary Anderson missed a field goal at that point. second possession, Montana hands off to Roger Craig. Mike Merriweather hits him. The fumble picked up by rookie Dalton Hall, and he takes it back 49 yards. That made it 7-0. The second round pick out of Clemson with a big play. Forgetting Rod Woodson for now, their top pick. Just before the first quarter ends, Harry Newsome with the big punt, and I mean a big punt, as the Steelers down it at the 1 yard line. And so, the 49ers having their problems getting going. Second quarter, 3rd and 2 now for the Niners. Montana reading the blitz, dumps it to Roger Craig, but Dave Little stopped him cold. The big effort from the Steelers D continued all afternoon. Later in the second quarter, Mark Malone having a tough day. He only completed 9 of 33, but he got 27 yards here on this big completion down the middle to Merrill Hodge, the 10th round pick out of Idaho State, and he was inside the 5-yard line. They later scored from the 2 to make it 14-3. Second quarter, Gary Anderson hits this one from 50 yards out. Big points before the half. The Steelers up 17-3. Bill Walsh has obviously seen some better days. Third quarter, Steelers magic continues. 3rd and 6. Newsome punting. Jeff Fuller applying the pressure. So Newsome takes off 16 yards downfield. Picks up the first down when it could have been disastrous. But the woes continued for Montana. Looking for Joe Cribbs. Throws behind him. Dalton Hall deflects it. Comes down with it. Starts to run. He fumbles. But Mike Merriweather, Johnny on the spot, is there, and the Steelers are making the big play all afternoon. And who says players don't keep track of statistics? Ernest Jackson needs 9 yards to go over 100 for the day. He gets 12 on that run, 26 carries, 103 yards on the afternoon. And Bill Walsh ending up congratulating Chuck Knoll on this afternoon, the 171st win of his career that moves him into 5th place on the all-time list, past his former coach Paul Brown. The final 30-17. As the Niners were held to just 47 yards rushing today, Montana passing for 316 yards. But it was a big defensive effort by the Pittsburgh Steelers this afternoon, handing the San Francisco 49ers an opening day loss. Now, the other NFC West, AFC Central matchup today, the LA Rams at the Astrodome to face the Houston Oilers. We were supposed to see an improved passing look from the Rams, but 2/3 of their yardage today was still thanks to Eric Dickerson. And that opens some doors eventually for the Oilers. That's Rams' new offensive coordinator, Ernie Zampezi, on the far right. He taught Dan Fouts a bit at San Diego, and he's hoping to teach Jim Everett some of the same. But L.A. going to Eric Dickerson early. Gets a huge hole, races 57 yards before he's finally pushed out at the 9 by Patrick Allen. But the Rams failed to punch it in, had to settle for a 28-yard field goal by Mike Lansford. One of 3 on the day, and the Rams led 3-0. After another Lansford field goal, Moon trying to go to Rozier. Number 91, Kevin Green deflects it, bounces off of his right leg, never hit the ground. The interception, run back to the score. The Oilers say, what happened there? 13-3 at the half. It was a touchdown. It was an interception. Fourth quarter, 16-3 Rams. 3rd and long for Warren Moon and the Oilers. Rams put on the good rush, but Moon lets it go. And watch the rookie, Hayward Jeffries from NC State, make a nice catch to keep the drive alive. The Oilers hadn't been able to do anything all day, but in the end, they were able to move it. Rams' Greg Meisner with the pressure, but Moon finds Jamie Williams for the touchdown. 16-10, Rams out on top. The Oilers' next possession, Moon spotting Ernest Givens running the crossing pattern, and the speedster from Louisville goes 59 yards, takes it in for the touchdown. The point after was good, and the Oilers took the lead 17-16. All of a sudden, Moon is hitting. Had a lot of passes dropped on him early in this ballgame. The Rams try to come back. 2:53 left. The pitch to Eric Dickerson, but he is hit. He fumbles. It is recovered by Jeff Donaldson. And they're going wild at the Astrodome. Jerry Glanville with the big effort as the Oilers coming back 17-16. And that fumble recovery set up Tony Zendejas' field goal, and Houston took the lead 20-16. Last chance for the LA Rams. 35 seconds left. Everett back to pass, but it is picked off by Keith Bostic. It's a bad throw, and the Oilers go on to win at the Astrodome, their 5th straight regular season home game that they have won. 20-16 was the final, as the Oilers scored 17 points in the fourth quarter. Moon, 21 of 43 for 310 yards. Jim Everett, only 9 of 26 for 125 yards. Eric Dickerson rushing for 149 yards. The entire Rams team rushed for 147. So he was basically the entire offensive showcase for the Rams today. And the gentlemen, obviously, they were not able to show what they hoped they'd be able to show through the air this afternoon. Let's go back to Chris.
That is for sure, Gail. Thank you. And as far as the top teams in the NFC West are concerned, as John Lennon once sang, strange days indeed. The late games are now over. We'll show you highlights shortly. But it is a final now for Mile High Stadium. Keep it down, Tom. The Broncos over Seattle by the score of 40-17, scoring the last 33 points of the game. And the score we showed you a short while ago at Green Bay has stood up for the final, as the L.A. Raiders have opened up with a goose egg on defense, beating the Packers by a score of 20-0, even though Hilger was hurt early in the third quarter. We'll talk more about that game shortly. All right, back to those two games that we just saw with the big teams in the NFC West losing. Tom, I know the 49ers, we know they can pass, but as Gail alluded to, not much yards on the ground, and maybe that did them in.
Well, as Gail said earlier, 47 yards on offense rushing the football is not going to win you very many football games. And what they need is bigger days from Roger Craig. I think if they can get that along with a Montana passing game, they're going to have some success.
They do need Roger Craig to return to that form when he was a 1,000-yard rusher and just about a 1,000-yard receiver. So the Niners, looking for some answers, they just totally looked out of sync today. If you watched our preseason special on Friday night, then you know that this man to my left, Pete Axthelm, was starting to sing Love You Blue. You picked the Oilers in the AFC Central. We laughed. You're right.
You were getting ready to throw a net over me, as I recall.
That's right.
Of course, there's still 15 games to go. But the Oilers are tough at home. And, you know, Chris and Gail were talking before about this game isn't played on paper. And, in fact, it becomes more significant today because we had two dirt teams from a dirt division come into carpets in a carpet division. And, of course, both home teams won on the carpet. That's often a big factor in upsets that we don't think about when we're analyzing these things. Another question, a lot of people were looking for this new Ram offense under Ernie Zampezi. What they got was Eric Dickerson, field goals, the same old song, this time a very blue ending.
The carpet game syndrome, yes, we know it well. All right, you are right, Axe, and so touche to the AFC Central. Next up, a passing fancy between the Jets and the Bills, and a runaway at Tampa Bay. Steve DeBerg and the Bucs waste the Falcons away in Margaritaville. Stay with us.
Maybe you think the Giants will win it all this season.
You had a feeling there would be plenty of scoring between the Jets and Bills in Buffalo, and that's why we bring in now to NFL primetime John Saunders, whose addition skills are superior to the rest of us. John.
Plenty of adding to do in this one, and as you would expect, a close one as well. Last season, when the New York Jets were off to a 10-1 start, they piled up two of those wins against Buffalo, but the Bills lost those two by a total of just 5 points. In fact, thanks to quarterback Jim Kelly, the Bills were in many of their losses last year. Today, again, it would be the Kelly and his counterpart, Ken O'Brien, show. Ken O'Brien, of course, of the Jets. A beautiful day in Buffalo. 75,000 on at Rich Stadium. Machine gun quarterback Jim Kelly got things going in the second quarter. He finds another alumnus from the United States Football League, Trumaine Johnson, for the 26-yard touchdown. Watch the hit Johnson takes as he takes it into the end zone. Buffalo up 7-0 early. That opened the floodgate of points. O'Brien to Wesley Walker, 55 yards on the bomb. What a great grab by Walker, who is legally blind in one eye. You can't tell him to catch that ball. Now, final Jet drive of the half. O'Brien, 6 of 7 on the drive. Here across the middle to Mickey Schuler. This Schuler's 300th NFL career reception, and it's good for a touchdown, 14-7 at the half. Jets get a field goal to make it 17-7, but Kelly closes the gap by hitting Chris Burkett. Now watch it again on the replay on this 6-yard touchdown pass. Burkett has Russell Carter all over him. He's draped across him like a rug and still makes the catch. 17-14, Jets on top. A Jets touchdown, and it's 24-14 late in the third quarter. Chris Burkett is nailed again by Russell Carter. Carter trying to do anything he can to stop the completion, and he does. It's pass interference, but he can't believe it. He holds up his hand, says, "I did nothing," says Carter. Later in the fourth quarter, big Buffalo mistake. Kelly's pass is deflected and picked off by the linebacker, Bob Crable. He carries this one down to the 4-yard line as he has Jim Kelly, the quarterback, making the tackle, getting it down to the 4. And here's the clincher. Johnny Hector, who had 2 touchdowns on the day, goes over the top, does break the plane, gets it in the end zone, 31-28. That is the seventh consecutive time that the New York Jets have beaten the Buffalo Bills, although the last three times it's been very close. Ken O'Brien of the Jets, 24 of 35 for 276 yards and the two touchdowns. Johnny Hector, you saw two touchdowns on the ground. Jim Kelly, another good day. 25 of 42, 305 yards, and three touchdowns. Now, the Bills have just one win in their last 20 games against playoff teams. So, as you can see, Buffalo and Jim Kelly cannot do it by themselves. Let's go back to Chris and to Tom.
All right, John, we'll see you a little bit later on in the program. Meanwhile, let's go down from Buffalo, where it was nice today, to Tampa Bay, where it's always nice. And Coach Ray Perkins made two obvious statements in the preseason. Vinny Testaverde will be great, but he's not ready at quarterback. So Steve DeBerg will be his starting QB until Perkins decides when he can win with Vinny. Perkins also staged unheard-of three-a-days in preseason, vowing that if nothing else, the Bucs would be in great shape this year. At home against Atlanta, Perkins was 2-0 in his moves. Ray Perkins said, Steve DeBerg, number 17, you're my starter. Meanwhile, on the sidelines, the $8 million man, Vinny, will have to wait his turn. DeBerg got the Bucs moving on their first possession. Third down, look into the end zone. Joel Williams, linebacker of the Falcons, grabs Jeff Smith's jersey. Pass interference, Buccaneer first down. Then on another third down play, DeBerg to Bill Freeman, 11 yards touchdown, 91-yard drive, 7-0 Tampa Bay. The defense inspired by the offense's play. David Archer to Aubrey Matthews. He is nailed by Rick Woods, not shy of the first down. DeBerg's later in the first quarter has the Bucs moving from the 10. DeBerg looking for Mark Carrier. This is called a nice defensive play, it looked like, but the referee says pass interference in Scott Case. He can't believe it, and it would cost the Falcons. Third and goal from the 5. DeBerg to Gerald Carter. Touchdown, beating Rady, 14-0 Bucs. Ray Perkins said, this is great. Marion Campbell in his first start in stint 2 in Atlanta says, what is going on? Second quarter, David Archer under pressure, as he would be all day long. Rick Woods comes down with the deflected ball. He could go all the way. Woods smells the end zone, but he is knocked out at the 2-yard line, a 42-yard return, but just two plays later. Gerald Carter, number 87. You saw him in motion, the bottom of your screen. Now he makes the cut and the pass from DeBerg, touchdown at 27-3. Owner Hugh Culverhaus says, this is the greatest. Tampa Bay defense had 19 sacks last year at NFL low. But Archer saw this. Kevin Kellen and Ron Holmes, 4 sacks today for the Bucs as they rolled over the Atlanta Falcons by the score of 48-10. The most points the Buccaneers have ever scored in a game. Their last 4 games last season add up their offense, 48 points. So that gives you an indication of how they played at least today. Now, Tom, Steve DeBerg was a teammate of yours, as DeBerg first played with the 49ers, and then he gave way to Joe Montana. Then he played with the Broncos, giving way to Elway, and eventually he'll give away to Vinny. But DeBerg showed that he can play, too.
Well, DeBerg not only can play, he's a student of the game. He tends to watch a lot of film. He spends a lot of time in his notebook. And maybe most important, he keeps a tape recorder with him all the time so that he can review what a coach says to him. And his success is keyed by preparation.
He doesn't get bummed out of the whole situation. I mean, he knows his role, doesn't he, with the Elway situation?
Well, I don't think it's a happy situation for him. I'm sure he'd like to remain the starter, but he knows when guys come in who make $8 million that they're going to play eventually.
And Vinny, on our pregame show on game day, said that DeBerg has been great in teaching me the offense, too. So Steve DeBerg is not holding back any secrets to keep his job a little longer. He looks like he'll keep his job a little longer today with the 5 TD passes. The AFC West head knocker is coming up soon between Denver and Seattle. We'll show you highlights. Meanwhile, way down yonder in New Orleans, the Saints look divine against the AFC Central champs. Don't go away. NFL primetime is right back.
All right, listen.
In the Superdome, count on the Saints to be blessed. New Orleans had a tall task today to waylay the Cleveland Browns, but they were ready as they looked like they were playing on a much higher field than that one in the Superdome. First quarter, Saints running the ball. Look at Reuben Mays, second-year man from Washington State. And, Tom, it's tough to catch a guy that has moves like this and power like this.
Well, tough to catch him and a guy that big. I don't know if you want to catch him. He's as hard to bring down as any back in the league.
147 yards today. That was a 26-yard gain. Second quarter with the Saints leading 7-0. Bernie Kosar to Clarence Weathers and an 88-yard drive. Tied the game at 7 at the half. After a Mack fumble on the first drive of the second half for Cleveland, Bobby Hebert goes to work. Look at the catch by Mike Jones, who takes a belt from Frank Minifield, but he holds on. Gain of 11 on a first down. Next play from the 17-yard line, Hebert, play action. Clancy pressures him, but looks in the corner to his tight end, Colby Brenner, who caught two touchdown passes. That a beautiful play. 14-7 Saints, they're indoors, but so what? The umbrellas were out. I told you they're blessed. Kosar and the Browns coming right back. Second and one from the 30. Surprise, they're going to pass. Brian Brennan, touchdown. Once again, Cleveland comes from behind and not the game at 14-all. Third and goal from the 5-yard line. Here come the Saints. Hebert from the spread. Watch the inside hand up to Dalton Hilliard and the rookie guard 65, Steve Trapillo, with a nice block. Fourth quarter, third and goal from the 3. Bernie Kosar. A nice block by Dan Fike on Sam Mills, and we are tied again at 21-all. The Browns have their backs to the wall on the 6-yard line. Kosar back to pass. Bruce Clark, number 75, gets him in the grasp. They call a safety in the fourth quarter. Marty Schottenheimer cannot believe it because the Saints have gone up 23-21. In the grasp rule, Tom, what do you think of that rule?
Well, it's purely a judgment call. Had the call gone the other way or had Kosar gotten hurt, then you see a Schottenheimer outraged at the refs for not calling.
You're right. Special teams played a big role for New Orleans. Brian Hansen's punt hangs. Ricky Jackson, perhaps the best defensive player on the Saints. He's on teams. Look at the play he makes to keep it out of the end zone. Vaughn Johnson nails it at the 1. Once again, Saints defense goes after Kosar after that play. Kosar is nearly broken in half on the safety blitz by Brett Maxey. Fumbles out of the end zone. Two safeties, 25-21 Saints. Now after a Morton Anderson field goal gives them a 7-point lead. The Saints try to pressure the Browns with Bernie Kosar to Ernest Biner on the screen. Breaks a couple of tackles, heads for the sidelines. 9 seconds to go, first and 10 Cleveland. First Hail Mary. Webster Slaughter, Reggie Langhorne, and Clarence Weather in the end zone. Ball is tipped once, twice, stripped by Johnny Poe, and it is knocked out. Here is the next one. Kosar deep again. And the Saints withstand 2 Hail Marys, and the Saints have upset, yes, Faith, Hope, and the Pope. Would this be the year that New Orleans finally goes over 500? It could be. Jim Moore and company look like they know what they're doing as they win at home over the Cleveland Browns 28-21. And in this ball game, Tom, Cleveland never began a drive farther than their 20-yard line. So obviously defense and special teams, when you force Kosar and the offense to make moves like that, you're putting a heck of a lot of pressure on the opposing offense.
Well, when you force any team to try to drive 89 yards to score, they're going to have problems. I still think, though, psychologically, they may not have recovered from what happened to them last year.
Now, they play the Broncos in the third week of the season. Now, I hate to say looking forward to a game when it's week one. Could that be possible? It's a Monday night game.
I don't think so. I think the Saints just played a little bit better than they thought they would. And the Broncos, they certainly will have a revenge motive when they meet the Broncos, but they're not thinking about that right now.
All right, Tom. So the Cleveland Browns, the lone AFC Central team, expected to win all the time, they're the ones that get off on the schneid. Cincinnati has never won an opener in the Sam Weiss era. They had never won one. And Indianapolis had never lost a game in the Ron Meyer era. Those were the forces at work in the Hoosier Dome today. Ron Meyer, when you're 3-0, you can dress as dapperly like this. Look like he's selling stock, but what the heck? He calls the shots for Indianapolis. Bengals first possession of the game. James Brooks sweeps to the right. Busts this run for 10 yards. And Tom, when you get blocking like the big guys like Max Montoya can provide, no wonder Brooks has some room.
Well, when you knock guys on their back like this, you're going to open up holes for backs.
Donnell Thompson said, Max, get out of here. I've seen enough of you already. It's the first quarter. Same drive, a few plays later. Boomer Esiason, 2nd and 7 from the 18. Brooks, this time on the receiving end, touchdown. Bengals lead at 7-0. Next Cincy possession. Watch Boomer, just before he steps out of bounds, fire to Rodney Holman, who beats the rookie, Freddie Robinson. Touchdown, 61 yards. They missed the point, but it's 13-0 Cincinnati. But the Colts weren't out of it. They fake a punt. There's Ron Stark going out of punt formation. Blair Keel, the blocking back, steps up. Takes the snap. He's going to keep it himself. First down. And the Indy fans say, we like this stuff. Give us more. Next play, 1st and 10 from the Colts, 48. Trudeau to Albert Bentley. No, it's the flea flicker. Back to Jack Trudeau. You want to see a great catch? Billy Brooks outleaping 2 defenders and then into the end zone for a touchdown, 13-7 at the half. Third quarter, since he gets sloppy. Snapped way over Boomer's head. He recovers it, but their drive was stalled. And when the Colts got the ball back, they go 79 yards, capped off by the leaping Albert Bentley, 2 yards, 14-13 Colts. Moved to the fourth quarter, breach with a field goal, Bengals lead at 16-14. Boomer looking for Chris Collinsworth, pumps once, then goes to the end zone. Yeah, that's pass interference on Eugene Daniels, and from the 1 yard line after that, Brooks scores to make it 23-14, but the Colts would not quit. Trudeau rolling, finding Tim Sherwood in the back corner, 23-21. The Colts tried to get the onside kick, it didn't work, but they did get the ball back late, but Trudeau just throwing it up for hope. But the Pope wasn't in the Hoosier Dome, you know, so Robert Jackson iced it with the interception, 23-21. The Bengals hold on over a very stubborn Indianapolis Colts team. Around the bend, as we told you, the Broncos and the Seahawks. That is coming up. We'll be back with that. Look at the other late game between the Raiders and the Packers and much, much more as NFL primetime continues. Stay with us. Axe, Jax, Gale, John, and yours truly will be back.
Listen, sweetheart, have you any...
The AFC West team that could against the AFC West team that would. The Broncos hosting the Seahawks at Mile High, and the folks in Denver were, as usual, about that high, maybe even higher. You know who was there? The Boz. We're at number 55 now, doing a lot of thinking before the game. The Boz was a factor early. John Elway on the scramble. The Boz said he would find him. Well, at least on this play he did. Just before he gets to the sideline, Elway learns what it is to take a hit from Brian Bosworth. A lot of tough hits today, as you would imagine. Everybody was hitting. Randall Morris, he is nailed by Dennis Smith right there. Now, Denver ball, Sammy Winder. And watch Freddie Young, a three-time Pro Bowler, pop him. Yeah, they were scuffing and battling in Denver. Early first quarter, Elway, ball is tipped. Number 45, Kenny Easley comes down with it for the INT for the Seahawks. Later on in that drive, David Craig to Darryl Turner, who less than every three catches makes it a touchdown reception. That's an amazing stat. Haynes has beaten 7-0 Seattle. But on Denver's next drive, Elway, play fake. Then to Steve Sewell out of the backfield. Takes it away from Terry Taylor and Eugene Robinson. He goes all the way, 72 yards, and he knows he's in, tied at 7. On Seattle's next drive, Kurt Warner, number 28, goes 28. Watch the moves inside, then makes a couple of other moves, shakes a tackle into the secondary. Warner, though, shaken up on this play, seemed to be okay later. A few plays later, thanks to Kurt's run, he was fine because Warner caught the ball from David Craig, 14-7 Seattle. Second quarter, Denver ball, Gerald Willite is nailed by the Boz. Ball squirts free. Freddie Young is going to pick it up, and number 50 has a convoy. He says, there's the one man to beat, and it's a quarterback. Elway gets in there. He doesn't quite beat him, but it sets up a Norm Johnson field goal, 17-7 Seattle, second quarter. Did it change after that? I guess so. A couple of Rich Carlos field goals makes it 17-13. Then at the end of the half, Bobby Joe Edmonds collides with Tony Burst. Fumble. Mark Munford picks it up for Denver. A few plays later, with the clock ticking down in the first half, Elway with, does he have time here? Oh, you're not open, you're not open. Steve Watson with a beautiful catch, looked like he was throwing it away, and Chuck Knox upset because it is 20-17, Denver at the half. Seattle more problems. Craig, ball goes off Steve Largent's chest. Dennis Smith picks it off, and the Broncos in business. Chuck still not enjoying himself once again at Mile High Stadium. Setting up this play, John Elway to the big, and I mean big, tight end Orson Mobley, number 89, 27-17, 5-yard touchdown pass, late in the third quarter. Next drive for the Seahawks, Craig to Raymond Butler, but the ball is stripped. Dennis Smith, Mr. Opportunistic, around it again, recovers, another Seahawk turnover. This sets up the Denver flea flicker, the pitch back from Sewell, Elway, to Vance Johnson on the fly. 59 yards, 34-17, tack on a couple of field goals, and I'll tell you what, 33 straight points for the Broncos after the Seahawks led by 10 early in the second quarter, and the Denver Broncos win going away from the Seahawks by a score of 40-17, and I guess as we knew, Tom, you're going to have to score a lot of points to beat the Bronx.
Well, as I said earlier, the one thing that the Broncos can do is put up the points, and while that young defense learns, John Elway is going to win a lot of football games.
The defense is learning. Now, they were down 17-7. Now, we talked about leadership. Reuben Carter's gone. You're gone. Two other starters, Lewis Wright, Steve Foley on defense. Elway is the guy that has to come to the forefront as a leader, too. I guess he took it into his own hands.
Well, he took it into his hands on offense, but I think on defense we saw improvement. Even in the second half, I think Mike Harden, Dennis Smith played a lot better.
And Elway today had four touchdown passes, throwing for 339 yards. It was the third time that Elway has thrown for four touchdown passes in one ball game. Still to come, the rest of the AFC West, the Raiders at the Pack, and a nail-biter between a pair of teams that always open up well, the Chiefs and the Chargers. Stay with us.
There are about 20 small sedans to choose from out there, but if you're looking for the best value, you can stop right here. The new Mazda 323 SE has a bunch of technical sophistication like fuel injection, a list of standard features that just won't quit, all backed by the best warranty in its class. I'm not kidding. You've got to check out this Mazda 323.
A better economy car value comes from our intense commitment to your total satisfaction. That's the Mazda way.
Nature can be devastating. The wood on your home needs protection. A water sealer waterproofs. Olympic Clear Wood Preservative does too. And Olympic gives you linseed oil that strengthens wood fibers. And additives to resist mildew. And preservatives to resist rot. Because wood needs a lot more than just waterproofing. Water sealers fade by comparison. Olympic, protecting wood for over half a century.
Break out of your old routine.
Flush and go for flush. Got too much you're busy doing. Fuss around with your shampoo. It's you got a shampoo that conditions too.
Flush and go for flush.
Pert Plus. It's shampoo plus complete conditioner all in one. For great hair, no fuss.
One shampoo conditions too.
Flush and go for flush.
So now you know about the Broncos and the Seahawks. John Saunders has kept his eyes on the rest of the division, and we bring him back now by very popular demand. John.
Thank you, Chris. The Kansas City Chiefs' new head coach, Frank Gans, built his reputation on molding the Chiefs' special teams into the National Football League's best. But he earned his nickname, Crash, as a pilot in the Air Force. So it seemed a contradiction that the pilot would rebuild the Chiefs on a ground game. But they've been worst or next to worst in the National Football League for the last 4 years, so they had to do it on the ground. True to his word, their second pick, 253-pound rookie back Christian Okoye out of Azusa Pacific, rumbles 8 yards. You haven't seen the best of it yet. Not much passing early in this game. No score in the first quarter. San Diego moving the ball, but Dan Fouts back to pass is picked off by Daron Cherry, who goes up and grabs it at the 20 and takes it up to the 45. Kansas City would capitalize on a Lowry 25-yard field goal to take a 3-0 lead. In the second quarter, Chargers are threatening, but Fouts again thwarted by, again, Cherry. He grabs this one off in the end zone. Chiefs secondary second to none on this game. Late in the second quarter, Okoye gets the ball again, and he's untouched. This guy is 250 pounds, and look at him run like he's a sprinter. Takes it into the end zone, 105 yards and 21 carries. 13-3 now in the fourth quarter. Fouts hits Gary Anderson. Anderson tight ropes the sidelines and takes it 34 yards, 13-10 is the score at this point. Later in the third, third and goal, Fouts again to Anderson. Nice grab, but he's waved out of bounds, and Al Saunders and his troops must settle for the field goal. On the ensuing kickoff, now you heard about Okoye. He was the number two pick. This is the guy who was the number one pick, Paul Palmer, out of Temple. Shows why he was the number one pick. They made a lot of questions about why he was going to play on special teams. Well, here's why. And Gans says it's an honor to play on the Chiefs special teams, and he shows it. Takes it in 20-13. Arrowhead crowd's going crazy as Palmer falls to the turf. San Diego, one more glimmer of hope. Todd Blackledge has his pass tipped, nearly intercepted by Danny Walters, but Stephon Page grabs the ball and makes the big reception, probably the biggest reception because there weren't many of them on the day. Saunders congratulates Gans as the Chiefs go on to win this one 20-13. Christian Okoye from Azusa Pacific, the second Chief, only the second Chief to rush for 100-plus yards since 1981. That's why they're rebuilding on the ground, first in 2 years. Dan Fouts, 21 of 39 for 270 yards. Only AFC West team to play out of division, the Raiders, who were playing the Packers. Forrest Gregg was blocking for Bart Starr years ago, 20 years ago, as a matter of fact, the last time the Raiders lost to the Packers. That was in Super Bowl II. We're supposed to have the kickoff, but the teams come across to shake hands, showing solidarity for the union and their negotiations for the strike. Meanwhile, in play, the Raiders with quarterback questions, Rusty Hilger, but now he has James Lofton to throw to. Lofton makes his return to Green Bay after the trade. Randy Wright starting for the Packers, not very successful. Feels the defense, as does Keith Paskett, incomplete pass. Not much Packer offense in the first half. Not much for the Raiders either. Rusty Hilger at quarterback goes deep to Lofton, but it's picked off by Dave Brown, who leaps and grabs lots of flags and lots of defense in the first half. Late in the second quarter, Marcus Allen takes charge, charges through for 14 yards, and then five plays later, third and goal, Allen gets the call and goes up and over for the touchdown. 7-0 Raiders at the half. Third quarter, Mark Wilson gets the call to get something going now and threads the needle to James Lofton. This is his first reception in the uniform of the Los Angeles Raiders, happy to get a new start, and he needed one after his offseason trouble. Third quarter, first and 10 for Green Bay. Randy Wright throws right into the hands of McElroy. 35 yards, he takes it in for the touchdown, 14-0. And Tom Flores has to like what he sees as the Raiders roll to the 20-0 victory. You know, it's been 122 games since the Packers were last shut out. That was December of 1978 against the Bears. Marcus Allen, 33 carries, a career high for him, for 136 yards as they win it 20-0. And as we can see, looking at that game between the Raiders and the Packers, a couple of teams with some problems at quarterback. Chris?
All right, John, but the Raiders do it. They could not lose this game and really think about winning the AFC West. This is some of the games that seem like the Raiders have to win. They did it 20-0. Still to come, the Cards reshuffle their deck against Dallas, and the Redskins and Eagles in a wild one at RFK. The NFC East spotlight in a moment.
ESPN Home Video presents Teaching Kids Football with Bo Schembechler. This 75-minute video cassette is designed to show parents and youth coaches how to teach children the basic fundamentals and techniques of the sport in a safe and fun way.
We want this to be a very positive experience for the young people that are playing for their first or second year of football.
Bo begins the training with the basics of offense and defense, describes the kicking game, including punting and place kicking, and then moves into drills to improve agility. Bo also stresses the importance of mental attitude and safety to start kids off right in the game of football.
This is not big-time football. It's Little League football, and it's played for fun.
Teaching Kids Football with Bo Schembechler, only $39.95. Order your copy today. Call 1-800-544-1000, only from ESPN Home Video.
The Washington Redskins hope to have things their way against the Philadelphia Eagles, a team they creamed at RFK a year ago. Very early, the Skins had to alter their thinking. It was hot, a hot day in the nation's capital. It's tough to stay cool and a priority. They were ready, the Redskins and the Eagles. First quarter, the Redskins received a major scare. Here's what I'm talking about. Reggie White flies through the defensive line, the offensive line, I should say, and he sacks. Jay Schrader landed heavily on his shoulder, leaving the game with a sprained shoulder. X-rays, though, fortunately negative. So Doug Williams comes in with a 3-0 lead. His first series ends with a gun strike to Art Monk. First touchdown pass in the NFL since 1982 for Doug. On the point after disaster, Cedric Brown blocked into Jess Atkinson. He goes out with a dislocated ankle. The kicker, Joe Gibbs, is saved. My goodness, we're already looking at the bench. Second quarter, Eagles strike back. Randall Cunningham to Mike Quick, who is just that, and the Eagles trail at 10-7. Eagles try some razzle-dazzle for Buddy Ryan. Only early the second quarter, so why not? An onside kick. The Redskins weren't ready. Bobby Moore pounces on the football for the Eagles. Just as the Eagles think they have the Skins stunned on the first play after that kick, Cunningham looks deep for Mike Quick. But Todd Bowles is there for the leaping INT, and the Redskins take over. Eagles tried a couple of fake punts, too. Both did not work. Tied at 10 in the second quarter, George Rogers busts his way to the line. And then, yes, the ball did cross the goal line, touchdown, but Rogers left the game with bruised ribs. Second half, Redskins come out smoking. Doug Williams, play action. Throwing deep. He's got the arm, you know that. And Ricky Sanders hauls it in for 57 yards down to the one. Later, a touchdown makes it 24-10. It's now 24-17. Doug Williams feels the wrath of Reggie White. Schrader did earlier. White not only sacks him, but he steals the ball. And Reggie White, the minister of defense,
goes 70 yards with the touchdown, ties the game at 24. White is tired, but the Skins are stunned. In the fourth quarter, Washington a little urgent now. But Williams gets the time and finds number 81, Art Mock, for the touchdown. Williams, 17 of 27, two TDs today, 272 yards, 31-24. Eagles threaten late. Cunningham looking to Ron Johnson, but he's picked off by Barry Wilburn. Later on, Steve Cox came in to kick a field goal, a 40-yarder, which, oh, by the way, is the shortest field goal in the career of Steve Cox in the National Football League. And so Washington wins it by 10, 34-24. I know the Eagles lost the game, Tom, but you were looking all day long and commenting about Reggie White. Did defensive players stand out?
We talked about it even before the game started. He is a man among boys in any league.
He certainly showed that today. But the Redskins' Doug Williams showing a little spark there shows he is not rusty whatsoever. And you have to be happy for Doug, a man who has bided it. Is that a word? His time. And shows that he still has the talent to win in the National Football League. We'll get the dictionary out in the break. Two other NFC East teams went to the wire. And with a look at those games, here's Gail Gardner.
Okay, Chris, thank you. You know, despite last year's nightmare season, the Dallas Cowboys entered Busch Stadium in St. Louis today with all sorts of history on their side. They are always strong in season openers. They've beaten up on the Cards significantly this last decade, and St. Louis hadn't won a home opener since 1975. Neil Lomax becoming a key with Kelly Stoker unsigned. The Cards' first possession, Lomax hooks up with Roy Green, who beats Everson Walls. 44-yard completion, a sign of things to come, led to a field goal that made it 3-0 St. Louis. On defense, Cards were stunting and blitzing early. Much of the blitzing by the defensive backs. Leonard Smith drops Danny White for an 8-yard loss. Fumble coming after the whistle. The combat is blitzing, and without Mike Sherrard, they went to tight end Doug Cosby. And to Herschel Walker coming out of the backfield. Walker with a 37-yard game, 7 receptions, 90 yards for Walker. The Cowboys had a 6-3 lead into the fourth quarter. Danny White, whose right wrist was injured in 86, it's still sore. He banged it on Curtis Greer's leg on the throw. But White got up, shook off the pain, and came back to throw a 20-yard touchdown pass to Gordon Banks. And the Cowboys were breezing 13-3. The Cards shut down all second half until there was a minute 58 left, and Lomax throwing 16 yards to Roy Green in the corner of the end zone. Ron Francis beaten on that play, 13-10, Cowboys still leading. Banner says don't give up, and Lomax on the field urging the crowd of Busch Stadium to come on, help us out. Cards drive down once again, 53 seconds left. Out of the shotgun, Lomax finds Green once again, beating Everson Walls once again. 22-yard touchdown pass that made it 17-13. And the Cards added another late score, 27-13. The final two touchdown passes to Roy Green in a span of 65 seconds broke that one open. Lomax, 17 of 34 for 269 yards. And as we alluded to, it was their first win at home, first win of a home opener at home since 1975. So big win for the Cards today. Let's go back to Chris.
All right, Gail, thank you. The times, they are changing. Still to come, early leads don't mean an easy win. That's what the Lions and Vikings found out. Plus, Pete will add them up after week number one. No need to weep. Stay with us.
If you've shopped for family cars, you've probably checked out Toyota Camry and Honda Accord. But your shopping list isn't complete until you've added this new Mazda 626 that has more interior room, more luxury features, and more standard equipment. And beats Camry and Accord by hundreds. You've just got to drive it. Once you do, I'm positive you'll be putting the 626 at the top of your list.
A better family car value comes from our intense commitment to your total satisfaction. That's the Mazda way.
You can keep on moving with Twix.
Old-timers versus Central High. Okay, youngster, you can kiss it goodbye.
Dance.
Round in the bases.
Catch those whippers, snappers, faces.
Chocolate, peanut butter, satisfaction. Like crispy cookie, let you stay in the action.
Won't slow you down.
When you gotta get around.
Twix, let's show them what you can do.
Try no home.
23 skidoo.
Do, you do. Keep on moving with Twix.
A year ago in week one, Detroit went into the Metrodome and shocked the Vikings 13-10. They tried for a deja vu today. Yeah, the Vikings do own a lead at home in the season series, but a lot of those games weren't played in this building. Wade Wilson felt the pressure today, starting for Tommy Kramer.
First and 10 on his own 34. The ball bounces away from Anthony Carter. And James Griffin returns it to the 38-yard line of the Vikes, setting up a 3rd-and-3 for Detroit on the Viking 10. Chuck Long, starting QB these days for the Lions, looks for his tight end. I said I wouldn't do it, but Rob Rubik could not come up with the cube right there. Incomplete. Field goal by Eddie Murray. He had a couple of short ones. 6-0 Lions now. Vikings down 6-3 in the second quarter, but Dwayne Galloway picks the bounce, and Detroit in business again on the turnover. Two interceptions of Wade Wilson. Floyd Peters calling the defensive signals for the Vikings. As Chuck Long, it's 3rd-and-6 on the 8th. He looks for Mark Nichols. Once again, they're in deep, but once again, the Lions can only convert on an Eddie Murray field goal. He'd have 4 of them. This is a 24-yarder, all short, but field goals instead of touchdowns would cost him. 2nd-and-9 from the 25. Wade Wilson overthrows, and guess what? Dwayne Galloway is there for a second INT. He could go all the way. Not quite, though. He steps out of bounds at the 4-yard line. Long to Manley, touchdown, 16-3. Tommy Kramer says, Wade, you got to do this. So at the end of the second quarter, Wilson comes back to the rookie, DJ Dozier, out of Penn State. Touchdown, 16-10. Now, on the Detroit sidelines, Darryl Rogers is upset, and Wilson keeps moving. In the third quarter, Wade Wilson from the shotgun to his burner, number 81, Anthony Carter. And he is long gone for a touchdown. And it's a 19-17 Detroit lead, but it's slipping away because Dozier flies for a 1-yard touchdown. The Vikings lead 24-19, and then momentum continues late in the third. Wilson, when he played in Canada, Leo Lincoln Locomotive Lewis, touchdown, 24 yards. The Vikings up 31-19. They add another field goal by Chuck Nelson, and they win it by a score of 34-19. The Vikings spotting the Lions the early lead, then move.